Hey Sumners, and welcome to our in-depth analysis of SKT Mata's Volibear play. He was actually a part of Samsung White, the team that won 2014's Worlds. Mata was also the MVP of the tournament, and the SSW Thresh skin that many of us know and love today was directly inspired by him. Today, we'll see him utilize expert knowledge of Volibear's kit and damage in order to score an easy 15-minute victory. Before we get started, I want you to visit ProGuides.com if you want to see huge improvements to your rank right now. With their Pro Pass, you get exclusive Pro courses, and ProGuides has a feature called InstaPro, which provides instant 24/7 on-demand coaching from the best of the best. Over 100,000 gamers have used InstaPro today and ranked up significantly, so don't miss out on this opportunity, and rank up now using the link below. Having said all that, let's first explain some characteristics of Volibear that Mata was able to take advantage of, and then cover the runes and items he chose. We'll begin with his Q, Rolling Thunder. This is his Flip the Table ability. Namely, he will gain bonus movement speed, and his next basic attack becomes empowered, flipping the target backwards. He can combo this with his E, Majestic Roar, where he deals magic damage to all nearby enemies, knocking them back and slowing them for 3 seconds. The most overlooked part of this ability is that enemies who are dashing or are airborne during Majestic Roar are dealt an additional 8% of their maximum health as magic damage. As we said, he can activate this additional damage by using his Q, and that is his main combo, but he can also use it when the enemy champions use their dashes. As you can see, everyone on the red team has a dash. Aatrox's Q and E, Nidalee's Cougar W, Irelia's Q, Kai'Sa's Alt, and Leona's E. This is an additional soft counter that Volibear has in this specific match. Next up, his W, Frenzy, can get stacked 3 times. Upon the third stack, Volibear can activate it to bite the enemy target, dealing increased physical damage the lower HP they are. In the match, Mata will actually rack up a couple kills by finishing off the champs with a W. His ultimate, Thunderclaws, doesn't have any CC, so it's not really relevant for Volibear's support, it just adds a bit more AoE damage. And lastly, his passive, Chosen of the Storm, means that Volibear will rapidly generate health once he drops below 30% HP. This is super helpful because usually he will run into the center of a fight, pop his abilities, then once Aftershock wears off, he'll still be able to survive thanks to this health regen. Exactly because of that extended survivability it provides to a tanky engaged champion like Voli, Aftershock is the best keystone for him. Following that, we have Demolish, Bone Plating, Unflinching from Resolve, Hextech Flash Traption, Cosmic Insight from Inspiration, 1 Attack Speed, and 2 Armor Shards. He picked Demolish instead of Font of Life, which is another viable rune on Volibear, because he was so certain in winning the lane with his Lucian that he wanted additional pressure onto the tower once they push up to it. Bone Plating gives him additional tankiness immediately, as opposed to conditioning in the same row, and it also helps against Burst from Kai'Sa. Even though Revitalize would heavily increase the heal of Voli's passive, Unflinching is just that much more consistent. Plus, with Hextech Flash Traption, he'll be able to gain its bonuses much more often. Also, the Hex Flash will help him get the Q flip faster because he can just pop out of the brush and catch his opponents off guard. Cosmic Insight gives better cooldowns, and picking an Attack Speed Shard will allow him to stack W quicker. And lastly, going with double armor shards was situational since the enemy team is composed of 2 heavy ad bruisers, as well as Kai'Sa, who will primarily deal physical damage. Alright, let's begin the gameplay. As Volibear support, you typically just want tanky stats, except for mobility boots for better roaming, of course. Because this game ended up being so short, Mata only got to finish his remnant of the aspect support item. But if the game went longer, he would have also built a Righteous Glory, then some situational items such as Frozen Heart, Zeke's Convergence, Gargoyle's Stone Plate, Dead Man's Plate, etc. The enemy Leona places an early ward in the Tribush, and Camille decides to walk over it and enter the red bot side jungle, thus letting everyone know that vertical jungling is happening. Because of this and the superior early levels of Lucian, Volibear, and Camille, the red team bot lane needs to play super safe because of the constant threat of Camille ganking. Mata knows about this advantage and keeps positioning himself in front, ready to flip anyone who gets too close. As the 8th and 9th minion begin to go down, which will give him level 2, he starts running forward with the Q activated, trying to look for some immediate level advantage cheese. He doesn't find anyone because the enemy duo positions well, but in low and mid elo games, you can often use this tactic to get yourself a very good early trade. Just make sure you level up the correct ability. On the other side of the map, Nidalee starts chasing Fiora, who is seemingly running towards mid lane. Mata immediately sees this on the minimap and looks to rotate mid to assist, but he's not level 3 yet, so he does this quick step backwards to catch the XP of this minion, getting just enough to level up. Sadly, this is only 3 minutes in the game, so he has no boots of mobility and can't come mid fast enough, and his Sylas dies. Worth mentioning is the fact that if Lucian Nivoli didn't push up the wave this far up, this rotation wouldn't have been possible in the first place. Going back to bot lane, Mata keeps positioning in the front of his Lucian, acting as a meat shield even though he's not zoning anymore. Why is this? Well, because a couple of things. Firstly, Volibear doesn't have a long-range engage ability, such as the hooks of Pyke, Thresh, or Blitzcrank, so positioning in the brush like those guys won't work for Voli. Secondly, if Leona engages with her E, Zenith Blade, it will root the last champion struck for 0.5 seconds, and it will bring Leona to them. In this case, the one getting hit would be Lucian, but then Volibear would immediately flip her to the side, allowing his AD carry to kite and get an equal trade back. That doesn't happen, but what did happen is that during the laning, Kai'Sa got slowly poked with Lucian's abilities, and now she's sitting at around 80% HP. Mata, knowing the damage output of both Volibear and Lucian is insane at level 3, notices an opportunity, and within a single second, flashes, flips Kai'Sa over, and waits until the last possible moment of her being airborne to activate his E, getting 93 damage instead of the 40 to 50 that he would normally deal. The additional CC of the E allows Lucian to unleash his full combo, and with an ignite ticking, they burst Kai'Sa in the span of 3 to 4 seconds without Voli even having to use his W Frenzy. They don't overcommit for Leona, instead choosing to push out the wave. She thinks it's a good idea to aggro the new minions so that they don't hit the tower immediately and Kai'Sa can pick them up. This is typically a good tactic when there are no enemy champions in sight, but both Volibear and Lucian are still there with relatively high HP bars. So Voli flips her into the minion wave and finishes her off, now utilizing Frenzy for that percentage of missing health damage. With two kills on the scoreboard, Voli and Lucian recall. Mata prioritizes getting Boots of Mobility over upgrading the support item because he sees a possible fight brewing in the mid lane. And sure enough, he gets there just in time to help Sylas against Nidalee and Aurelia. These two overextend for Sylas, and Lucian rotates from bot and picks up two kills for himself. Even though Volibear drops to around 100 HP, he doesn't recall because of his passive and Relic Shield healing in the lane. That was an explosive 6 minutes, so let's summarize what happened so far. 1. Camille gets spotted going into the enemy bottom jungle, initiating vertical jungling and letting Kai'Sa and Leona know they need to play super safe. 2. Volibear keeps positioning in front of Lucian to both zone and later prevent any engage from happening. 3. Mata perfectly calculates the damage output of level 3 Volibear and Lucian, goes for a flash flip onto Kai'Sa, and she's bursted down immediately. 4. Leona makes a mistake of pulling the waves so Volibear and Lucian can capitalize. 5. Mata prioritizes Boots of Mobility over upgrading the support item so he can go assist in an upcoming skirmish mid lane. And this decision helps Lucian pick up 2 kills for 0 of the enemy team. 6. Knowing the strength of his passive and Relic Shield, he doesn't recall, instead keeping up the pressure. It's not looking good for the red team, and it's only going to get worse. At 6:25, Mata goes into the brush and pretends to ward, and because red team has no vision there, they automatically assume that Voli placed a ward. You can even see them question mark ping the brush. With established priority, Volibear is now free to roam up the river, place wards, clear enemy wards, or even gank mid. He knows it's okay to do this as long as the new enemy wave doesn't arrive into the bot lane, and the way he knows this is by looking at his own minion wave, because it mirrors the opponent's wave. When it gets to your own tower, you usually want to go back to the lane, but this time Mata saw an opportunity to gank Aurelia. She plays it very safe so no actual gank happens, but it was a good attempt at putting down pressure. At 7:45, Camille spots Nidalee in her own jungle and a fight breaks out. Lucian and Volibear quickly clear the minion wave and rush to help, putting Kai'Sa and Leona into a disadvantageous situation. Either stay under tower, pick up the wave and potentially let your Nidalee die, or go join her in a 3v3, losing the wave. Leona tries to go help her while Kai'Sa stays under tower, but Mata is quick to hex flash over the wall and stop Leona. No kills happen, though Camille does steal away the blue buff, then proceeds to attempt a gank onto bot lane. Throughout this skirmish, blue team managed to establish very good vision in the enemy jungle, simultaneously clearing the red team's vision, so that they now have zero idea if Camille is bot lane, top lane, or backed. This allows Camille herself to reposition from here to here. And then, with Mata's opening engage, they pick up a kill on Kai'Sa. Aurelia paths down to try to find a return kill on Camille, but because she went in all the way to the tower and into a 1v3 situation, she's quickly deleted. Leona wanted to help her, but she is also quickly bursted down for overstepping. Happy with the outcome, blue team recalls and Volibear seeks to roam top lane. Important thing to note is, if you want to roam in your own games, let your AD carry know and tell them to play safe until you return. Lucian realized that he was left alone, so he naturally plays passively, not following his wave after pushing. Instead, he goes to the Tribush to place a control ward, and after seeing Leona there, he retreats to clear the Krugs camp until the enemy wave crashes back into a safe spot to farm for him, which is here. Once Volibear gets back, he escorts Lucian up to mid lane, where Aurelia has already killed Silas, but thanks to Blue Team's advantage, they pick up 4 kills in reply, getting a Mountain Drake shortly thereafter. Just to add insult to injury, at 1507, Mata notices Aurelia, who's trying to farm, engages with Hexflash, and Lucian eliminates her once again. 40 seconds later, her team surrenders. To get this quick victory, Mata utilized excellent knowledge of both his and the other champions in the match in order to make aggressive but calculated plays, and help not only his AD carry, but everyone in the team snowball out of control. Let's highlight a couple plays from this game and mention a lesson that you could apply in your own games. 1. Position in front of your lane partner, both to protect them and zone the enemy duo. 2. Learn the damage output of not only your champ, but your teammates' champs. Then look to surprise your opponents with damage they didn't expect. 3. Always look around the map and try to find opportunities to help not just your AD carry, but the other teammates as well. 4. If you're going to roam to a different lane, let your carry know, so they can play safe and not die in a 1v2. 5. Whenever you push out the wave, walk into the river and begin to place wards. Clear enemy wards or look for a pick in mid or jungle. Alright guys, thank you so much for watching our entire in-depth analysis of Mata's Volibear play. We hope you learned something new that will help you in your own climb. Once again, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel or visit ProGuides.com for more high-level League of Legends insight. On ProGuides.com, we've partnered with pro players to create courses designed to help you take your game to the next level, so don't miss out! Good luck out there on the Rift, guys, and we'll see y'all next time.